Going to nitty-gritty of the war, I thought I'd give you an overall bird's view of the war in few lines, so that when we're going further, you have the overall comprehensive picture of the war in a very, very brief form. I must tell you that this is the first of the four wars that India has fought with Pakistan. All the wars with Pakistan, if I may use the word, are Kashmir-centric. And another point that I want to highlight is all the wars have been imposed on India by Pakistan, none that India initiated. And a good point is, despite good strategic planning by Pakistan generals and surprising Indian generals or India came on the top in a matter of time and defeated the nefarious designs of the Pakistan generals. I can give you various examples on this. Now, just going through the brief part of it, Pakistan attacked Kashmir, not India, Kashmir on October 22, 1947. The Pakistan forces comprise basically tribal militia, supplemented by Pakistan regular forces. So the leadership was in the hand of Pakistan Army, where the working soldier was a crime-prone, if I may use the word, militia, tribal militia. They were faced by Maharaja's state forces, which have their own limitation as far as professionalism is concerned. Soon, Maharaja realized that he cannot hold the onslaught of the Pakistan forces, and he started looking for a way out. And the only way out for him was to sign an instrument of accession. Only then India could come in, which he had no option now. He became so nervous that he went and signed the instrument of accession. That is what Pakistan objects, that he was forced, coerced by India. It was not a voluntary accession. And raiders by this time, when he agreed to sign the accession, raider has already reached outskirts of Srinagar and outskirts of Srinagar airfield. By the time the Indian forces arrived, the situation was quite bad. And finally, with the help of the UNO, United Nations, ceasefire was signed on the night of 1st, 2nd January 1949. Now, I have given you this bird's eye view of the whole war from the day it started to the day ceasefire was signed. I want to give you a little background of the Kashmir Valley. J&K gentlemen in those days comprised of small states of Hindu and Muslim population. And surprisingly, the state was known as Punjab Hill States, not J&K. It was known as Punjab Hill States. It soon became, with the Mughal Empire established in India, the J&K or Punjab Hill States became vessels of the Mughal Empire, particularly effective from Akbar's time onwards. Finally, the Kashmir fell to control of Maharaja Ranjit Singh, who also lost later on to the British. The Indo, or should I say, Anglo-Sikh War, which was fought between the Sikhs and the British, it was fought in 1845. The Sikhs lost the war. Kashmir went to the hand of East India Company. Having helped East India Company, Gulab Singh was sold, Kashmir, that he caused 7.5 lakh, and he established them the what you call lineage gloves. He became the first Maharaja laying the foundation of the Dogra dynasty in Kashmir. Now that, gentlemen, is the total background of Kashmir. I want to bring out another aspect, very unique aspect of Kashmir war, never seen anywhere in the history of human conflict. The first point that I want to raise, this is the only or first conflict where forces from the both countries, India and Pakistan, were led by a third country. Both the countries were, of course, were led by the British. The commander-in-chiefs were British, the chiefs were British, the senior generals were British, the working at lowest level were British. Entire mechanics of manpower were British. This is something very unusual. The British thus managed to maneuver decisions, not article decision, the way they wanted. I must tell you also, this is the time that the British were still global power. At the end of the World War II, British still global power. The Americans were just coming up. America had not yet hit global power. And British had their own design. And in this act that was passed for Independence Act, the British said, no British soldier will fight from chief down to a soldier in between a war between India and Pakistan. But yet, right from Mountbatten down the line, they all positioned themselves at important position where they could take decision or nullify the decision taken by Indian staff. I give you one example of this before I proceed further. When India agreed to Hari Singh that we'll help you, the troops had to be airlifted. This committee of comprising of Mountbatten down the line overruled, we don't have the aircraft, so we can't send the troops. Like this, they were playing against the decision being taken by the Patel had to requisition all civilian aircraft to airlift the troops to Srinagar. Now that was a game the British were playing. On the face of it, nothing. But in reality, they were holding everything. Now, second point about this uniqueness, Mountbatten was the constitutional head of India as a Governor General. When the Defense Committee was formed, he made himself the chairman and he put Nehru, Prime Minister, and Home Minister as sitting members of the committee. I cannot visualize a situation where a constitutional head becomes the chairman and the Prime Minister becomes a sitting member. Very unusual situation. How it happened, how it was allowed to happen by the Prime Minister or by the Home Minister is a matter of conjecture. But all I can say, it did tremendous damage to the planning and execution of Indian troops in Kashmir. Now, let's come on to actual partition and what happened. With this background, I think you have a good idea. Now, with Independence Act 1947 being passed, as per Article 2, sub Article 4, the suzerainty of British over the Indian princely state had expired. Now, I don't know whether you understand the difference between sovereignty and suzerainty. Sovereignty means you have total control and right over the territory. Whereas suzerainty means certain degree of control or power over the independent territory. So British exercised suzerainty over all the 5, 6 and 7 princely states in India. And Partition Act says the princes have the authority right to accede to Pakistan, to accede or to accede to India and make the matter worse or remain independent. See how the British were playing around. Can you imagine independent states, 500, 600 independent states, some going to Pakistan, some to India, and some become independent within the geographical entity of India. Now, Hari Singh was under tremendous pressure from Jinnah because he felt it's a Muslim state and the Hindu Raja, it must come to Pakistan. On the Indian side also, he was being pressurized. But he soon realized that he had to take a decision. He was inclined to remain independent. He was vacillating all the time. And a stage came when Jinnah realized that he is not likely to join Pakistan. And that is the time Jinnah took a major decision and he asked his army chief, General Gracie, who was a British, to plan the war, plan the attack on Kashmir. Now, when Jinnah asked General Gracie to plan this, General Gracie immediately said no. He had no authority because as per the act, no British was to take part in any conflict situation between India and Kashmir, Indian Pakistan. Pakistan hurriedly Asia available, but this was a period immediately after independence. There was a total chaos. Things are not in order. So he got hold of whatever forces minimally was able to get, and moving forward and going to Cham, Nowshera, Srinagar, Skardu, northern region. He gradually went through this place and occupied them slowly. Sorry, gentlemen, I'll go back a little bit if you have missed it. I was talking to you at this stage when Pakistan invaded and state forces who were Muslim dominated walked over towards the Pakistan forces. Even Muslim dominated towns like Mirpur, Punch, Muzaffarabad, Domel, all the Muslim population revolted against the Maharaja Hari Singh. Hari Singh then realized the situation is unmanageable. He finally gave up and he sought help from India. His famous line was that India legally cannot enter Kashmir. It will be illegal ingression. And if you want help from India, you have no option but to sign the instrument of accession. So a stage came in Maharaja was left no option and he signed accession. Now, what was India's response when he signed the accession? First thing they did to take control of the situation is to bring in the forces. Number one, Sikh from Patiala or Amritsar, I'm not too sure, were airlifted to Srinagar and they engaged the raiders just outside Srinagar and managed to control the situation. This was the occasion, ladies and gentlemen, where the Defense Committee, dominated by the British, said we don't have aircraft to airlift the troops to Srinagar. And they were denied. Home Minister Patel had to then requisition civil aircraft and airlift the troops. There are many examples how the things were being disrupted by these people. By this time, the raiders, who were not regular forces, got involved into crime, rape, and loot. In fact, they did so much damage to Pakistan and Baramulla particularly, they didn't spare anybody. And other cities also. Indian troops, having established themselves practically, were able to wrest back from Pakistan all the major cities that Maharaja had lost. Baramulla, Uri, all were recaptured. A stage came after some time when a sort of stalemate had taken place. Each side was capturing and recapturing the same cities and towns. And at this stage, something happened that did some damage to India. The Gilgit scouts under a British colonel, and British scout comprised large area in Skardu, Kargil, and all the northern territory of what we call today. This colonel, British colonel, walked over to Pakistan, and thus northern territories came in possession of Pakistan without firing a single bullet by either side. That was a very major shock to India's side. Now, another major target that India had to protect was Jozila. If Jozila had been lost, then Ladakh would have been cut off. So our concentration on Jozila. You'll be surprised if I tell you that World War II small-sized tanks were dismantled, loaded on and taken to Jozila by road, reassembled there, and engaged into the war. It shocked Pakistan how tanks are firing, where have the tanks come from? And thus we were able to secure Jozila with the help of this war with the tank. And slowly after this, India started getting upper hand all the time and got Punch, Dras, Jozila, Kargil, all were recaptured by India. Now a stage has come. No major decisions were being forced on India and Pakistan against the advice of the professional army. Prime Minister Nehru decided to seek intervention from the United Nations. The Indian Army General briefed the Prime Minister. It's a matter of 1 week. The Raider and the regular army of Pakistan are on the run, and we don't need more than this time. Hold on. But Nehru, idealist that he was, he said, "You generals don't know." And he invited the United Nations, for which we're paying the price till today. India somehow failed to realize the strategic importance of JNK, and British played in the hand of Pakistan. They helped Pakistan. In fact, subsequently, the United Nations was being discussed for years in the General Assembly. British sided with Pakistan always. British had interests, as I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, that British were still part to reckon with, and their strategic interests in the Middle East oil, they were still ruling the world. Their interest was in Northwest Pakistan. They knew India will not give them the bases when they need it. Pakistan will allow them to operate from the Northwest bases. To secure the Middle East, oil was the criteria. But this game was never understood by India. And they went to UNO, and interestingly, India went to United Nations under wrong article, went on Article 35, Chapter 6, which deals with dispute between the countries. Ours was aggression against India. And against aggression, where is it? Article 6 deals with aggression. We did not go under that article. Ultimately, ceasefire was established and Pakistan walked away with 2/5 of JNK, leaving India with 3/5 of JNK. Only good thing that happened was that India got the valleys. India got 3 major valleys, because Pakistan got basically the mountains. Army was very unhappy on this decision of Prime Minister going to invite the United Nations. Then came the question of plebiscite, how to decide the future of this conflict. The ceasefire, as I mentioned earlier also, came into effect on 5th Jan 1949. Ceasefire was established after a year and a quarter war between India and Pakistan. This war lasted for a year and a quarter. The ceasefire terms and conditions were as follows. Pakistan shall withdraw all its troops, regular and irregular, from entire territory of JNK. India shall also withdraw troops, leaving behind sufficient troops in JNK to manage law and order. And once situation is and thereafter, the situation cools down, a plebiscite will be held to define the future of territory. What happened in reality? We are where we were in 47. Issue remains unresolved. Slightest any gathering, international gathering, at United Nations or elsewhere, Pakistan raises the issue of Kashmir. The basis of future war exists, continue to exist. That is the saddest part, whole Kashmir. Now I just, the basic mistake done by India was lack of awareness, not realizing the strategic importance of Kashmir, for which the British were working behind the scene. Ignoring the professional advice of the Indian generals and going to UNO at a time when the enemy was on the run, even Abdullah, who was the adversary, even he was not interested in retaining present PUK is a Punjabi dominated and not Kashmir dominated. Sheikh Abdullah was also not interested, nor did he advise the Nehru on this. Well, gentlemen, that's all I have to tell you about this war. The major issue behind this whole thing has been the British machinations, and situation remain as it is, as it was decades ago. Thank you very much.